Now, who could forget the scene in the Pixar movie Up where Carl tied all those balloons to his house and simply flew away?
Yeah, well, check out this uplifting scene in real life. It's Tom Morgan, a British thrill seeker who went flying across South Africa strapped to a camping chair carried by 100 balloons. So just why did they do this amazing journey? To tell us more, Tom joins us from Bristol in the UK. Tom, it's a pleasure to speak to you. Why did you guys pick South Africa and how much trial and error was involved?
We didn't pick South Africa, and an awful lot of error and quite a lot of trial was involved. And we originally picked Botswana, but it went so wrong with the winds in the salt flats where we were trying to do it, because the theory was it's a lot of empty space, there's nothing to crash into, but the winds just kept destroying the balloons. So in the end, we ended, last-ditch attempt, we had only enough balloons for one flight. So, and quite a lot of them had gaffer tape over the holes because we'd used them once before, and some string left over. And we ran to South Africa and someone had a big old shed that we could inflate them in where the wind wasn't. And, it eventually just about worked. Not how we intended.
Tom, I have so many questions. First up, how many beers deep were you when this idea came about?
Well, funnily enough, well, I don't remember coming up with the idea. I think I saw an old copy of Popular Mechanics that was talking about the Gordon Bennett Cup in 1906, which was this amazing balloon race. And I thought we could do something but way cheaper with party balloons. And I don't think, like, who hasn't wondered how many party balloons it would take to get them off the ground?
Oh, we've all thought it, Tom, but you actually went ahead and did it with a pretty cheap camping chair and some balloons. How dangerous was this? And did you ever think, what would happen if a bird popped the balloons? Like, how far were you going to fall back to Earth?
Well, okay, at some point, it's about 8,000 feet, so fair enough. Enough to make me quite flat. I think it's fair to say I was soiling myself from beginning to end.
What was the contingency if you fell out of the sky? You would have hurt yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the contingency. Being in a lot.
You, Tom, you're the founder of a group called The Adventurists. What bar this exactly do you guys do?
We pretty much this. We organise sort of stupid and dangerous things for people to do, like we do racing Ural motorbikes across frozen rivers of Siberia, which I think you're putting on the screen there. And then we had an air race down the coast of America and Africa. We do kind of large-scale adventures where people get lost and stuck. The world's longest horse race we organise, rebuilding Chinggis Khan's ancient postal system across the Mongolian steppe. All sorts of slightly ridiculous things.
Do you suggest these to each other? Or, I mean, is this something that you guys want? Like, is it a short straw kind of thing? Who gets to fly the balloons today?
No, it was a fight. No, I think, well, we organise these things for people to come and take part in. The plan was to organise the world's dumbest air race. But the goal was going to be that we'd all set off together and then the person who got the furthest in any given direction and basically was still alive was the winner. But because we did it so we did such bad planning in Botswana that we only had enough to inflate one set of balloons. So I was racing myself.
What I'm fascinated by is, okay, so you get up in the air, you're travelling across South Africa. How do you land? What's the how do you actually end the journey safely? Do you just kind of pop the balloons? You weren't even wearing a stack
exactly
hat in there,
right,
in that vision.
Exactly right. You pop the balloons, but it was surprisingly controlled, actually. So what I worked out was each time you pop a balloon, you start descending by about 0.2 meters per second. And I went for a wee, and that made me ascend by 0.1 meters per second. So you had quite a lot of control, as long as your bladder's full.
So how much control do you have over what comes next? What are you guys working on at the moment?
Well, next we're making, we've been locked down for a year, obviously, so we started making our own monkey bikes, which we used to do, we will do, again, races on. So we've made kind of a flying monkey bike, and then we're making an electric version of that. And then we're going to make these...
Hang on, what's a monkey bike? What's a monkey bike, Tom?
They're like they were designed in the 70s by Honda for a children's theme park. So we use them for long-distance adventures across all over the place, Peru, Morocco, Romania, and coming to the US and various other places. There they are. And then, the next thing we're going to do after that, we've got an electric version out coming out, which is kind of the ultimate adventure machine, I think, because they're tiny and perfect for ultra-long distance adventures on the worst roads in the world. And then we're going to make the flat-pack biplanes, which is sort of a mixture of IKEA and a plywood dinosaur, which is a fundamentally terrible idea.
You can always whack some balloons on it.
Yeah, exactly. What could go wrong?
Tom, you're
fun. This is awesome.
Yeah, well done, you. Keep us updated with your adventures and stay
come
safe.
Come along, join me.
Oh.
Better you telling us about it than us reading about
it. Yeah.
Good on you, mate.
We'll let you do it and you can tell us how it went.
Okay, cheers, guys.
Keep training, pal. All the best. That's awesome.